In certain latitudes, there comes a span of time approaching and following the summer solstice, some weeks in all, when the twilights turn long and blue. This period of the blue nights does not occur in subtropical California, where I live for much of the time I will be talking about here, and where the end of daylight is fast and lost in the blaze of the dropping sun. But it does occur in New York, where I now live.
The first lines from Joan Didion's latest book, Blue Nights, a memoir of love and even more loss, as the writer reflects on the life and subsequent death of her daughter, Quintana.
This book is called Blue Nights, because at the time I began it, I found my mind turning increasingly to illness, to the end of promise, to the dwindling of the days, to the inevitability of the fading, the dying of the brightness. Blue nights are the opposite of the dying of the brightness, but they are also its warning.
Didion is no stranger to personal tragedy. In the span of roughly 2 years, her husband, the writer John Gregory Dunn, and their only child, Quintana, both died. Joan Didion began her career working for Vogue magazine in the early 1960s and has gone on to write 5 novels and 8 previous works of nonfiction journalism, including such classic collections of essays as Slouching Toward Bethlehem and The White Album. In recent years, her focus has turned inward. The Year of Magical Thinking was written by Didion in the span of just 88 days, chronicling the first year following the death of her husband. It went on to win the National Book Award in 2005 and was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. And Joan Didion joins me now. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
You have said that the earlier book about your husband's death simply wrote itself, but not this book. What do you mean by that, and what's the difference, do you think?
Well, the thing that most people think is the difference when I say that is this is obviously a much more personal book and a sensitive material, and it's dealing with my daughter, who's not alive anymore. Mm-hmm. So, but that's not really what made it a harder book to write. It was a much harder book to write because there's no narrative in it. It's mm-hmm. entirely a reflection.
How did you do that? How did you do those reflections?
Well, that was the hard part.
Yeah.
That was, it was endlessly, it seemed to me, harder than any book I'd written in a long time. I mean, almost every book you write has naughty places in it that mm-hmm. that are hard.
Naughty as in difficult.
Difficult.
Not naughty as in...
Exactly.
But this one was especially hard.
This one was especially naughty.
Well, you know, you write about the fear of parenting, questions like, can I give this child enough love? You write about her uncertainties and sometimes depression
right.
through her life. Were these things that were always there, or were these things that you found upon these reflections?
They were things that were always there, and I didn't know it.
You didn't know it at the time?
I didn't know it at the time. I didn't find them entirely through the reflections. I started writing the book because I began to be aware of how much I had missed.
I mean, you're dealing with very difficult death, loss here, and we're in a culture of therapy, of closure, of healing. But I don't get the sense that's what it is for you. You're saying it's about working out how you think about
it. No, it's working out how I think about it. Well, you could say that was a form of healing, but it's not the form most people depend on.
Mm-hmm. But writing, in a sense, can bring you closer to your emotions, but it also can keep them at a distance.
That's true.
I was thinking of it because there's an interesting moment in here where you're looking back and you're remembering, I think you were looking at her journals, at Quintana's mm-hmm. journals, and you said you realized you were copy editing rather
right.
than sort of processing what she was saying.
In order to keep what she was saying at a distance. Well, that was a scary discovery, a discovery that really took me back, you know.
Do you think of writing as a way of keeping emotional distance or not?
Well, you do. Of course you do.
Yeah.
I don't know any. It's both a way of keeping a distance and a way of getting close. I mean, it's both those things simultaneously. Mm-hmm. It's a little tricky.
The latter part of this book becomes about your own growing frailty, about your fear of aging or the experience of aging as a writer and as a person.
Right.
Do you see that now as the subject in some large part of this book?
I think it became the subject. I mean, it had not been on my mind in the least when I began it. And of course, had I thought it through, I would have seen that I thought the book was going to be about children. Mm-hmm. But when you start talking about children, you're always talking about aging.
And mortality. Is that something you think you'd be writing on more in the future?
I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to write in the future. If something interesting comes to my mind, yes.
These things, again, heart tragedy and loss, after all this writing about it, the last two books, do you think such things can be explained or understood or prepared for?
No, I don't think you can prepare for them in the least. We're not probably put on earth to prepare. There are certain things that only by living through them do you learn to live through them.
Mm-hmm. And what about understanding them through writing about
them? Through writing about them. That's how you understand. That's how you start to understand them.
The new book is Blue Nights, Joan Didion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.